Alaska Insight is supported in part by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by viewers just like you. Thank you.
Why does healthcare cost so much more in Alaska than almost any other state? And what can be done to lower the expense? We'll talk about the high cost of healthcare coming up on Alaska Insight. A lot of factors contribute to the cost of healthcare in Alaska. There's the state's distance from the lower 48, which increases costs, and Alaska's large geographic spread with low population density. And there isn't much competition among providers up here. But even when those cost drivers are factored in, the cost disparity is outsized.
A study commissioned by Primera, the only insurance carrier offering plans on the individual market in Alaska, used claims data from 2014 and found that healthcare costs are more than twice the national average here. The Primera report states that doctors and hospitals in Alaska are paid double what Washington State physicians and hospitals are paid for similar services. Specialists like cardiologists are paid more than 2.5 times the national average. So what's behind these expenses? Dr. Alan Gross is an orthopedic surgeon who worked in private practice in Juneau from the mid-90s until 2013. He says he left his job because he was increasingly unhappy with the prices patients had to pay. He says specialists tend to have a monopoly here. And Dr. Gross says a rule adopted 14 years ago by the State Division of Insurance called the 80th percentile rule mandates that insurance companies must pay 80% of what a medical provider charges. Dr. Gross says that allows physicians to jack up their prices. He says the 80th percentile rule should be repealed.
We need to find a way to break up the monopoly power of these specialty groups so that they can be more competitive for people that believe that healthcare should remain a part of our capitalistic network. That might have to be done on a legislative level. We're always going to have geographic isolationism in Alaska, and I think most of us that live here accept that. How much are we willing to pay to bring and maintain specialists in the state really is the question that we're talking about here.
Dr. Gross says one good option may be allowing people to buy into the Medicaid program or replicating the Indian Health Service or IHS model.
I think the native healthcare system in Alaska is first rate. And if I could buy into that, I would in a second. There's this blueprint for healthcare in Alaska, which is an organization that was just formed that I was invited to participate in, which is looking at 5 aspects of healthcare in Alaska, increasing primary care, improving the coordination of care, looking into improving data analytics, price reform, and then also evaluating the social determinants and trying to improve upon the social determinants of health in Alaska.
Dr. Gross says state leaders, physicians, and insurance companies are all involved with working on a blueprint plan. He says he believes it holds a lot of promise for a better healthcare system for Alaska.
Joining me this evening to discuss the current challenges for reducing the high cost of healthcare in Alaska and what may be on the horizon are Julie Taylor. Julie is the CEO for Alaska Regional Hospital located in Anchorage. Hi, Julie.
Hello.
Thanks so much for being here tonight. And also Becky Hultberg. Becky is the CEO, president and CEO of the Alaska State Hospital and Nursing Home Association. Did I get that right?
You got it right, and thanks for having me here.
Yeah, thanks so much to both of you for being here. So let's talk a little bit. Becky, I want to start with you and talk, if I can get my paper straight here. We just heard from Dr. Alan Gross, an orthopedic surgeon who says specialists have a monopoly in Alaska, are charging more because insurance companies will pay it, not because it costs that much more to do business in Alaska. Becky, let's start with you and get kind of the statewide picture. We hear often that Alaska healthcare costs are expensive for a variety of geographic and demographic reasons. But what else contributes to it? What are the factors?
You know, there are a number of factors that contribute to high healthcare costs, not just in Alaska, but nationally. We're not immune to we see the same things happening here that are happening across the country. We're not that unique. Some of the factors specific to Alaska might make us a little different, but overall, things like poor health, the type of payment system that we utilize, the third-party payment system, lots of different factors impact healthcare costs. And they're common throughout the rest of the country. This is not a problem unique to Alaska. This is a problem that our entire nation is struggling with. And there's no one place that has figured it out. So we're all on this journey of how having to address how do we lower healthcare costs. And really, the goal should not be lowering costs, but lowering the rate of growth of those costs. It's the fact that our growth has been high that has led us to the situation that we're in.
Well, thank you for that, and we'll talk about what some of those things on the horizon may be for helping to lower that cost in a moment. Dr. Gross said that he thinks the 80th percentile rule mm-hmm. should be repealed. Do you think that would help? Is that helping, or is that contributing to the high costs? And this is the rule that says insurance companies must pay 80% of what are considered reasonable costs that physicians charge. What do you think about that?
I think we have to be very careful in looking at pulling out small specific things and attributing our healthcare cost problem to them. Healthcare is an ecosystem. It is incredibly complex. What you do in one area of the system could have unintended consequences in another. So do we need to address the 80th percentile? I think we need to look at it to see if it is one of the factors contributing to cost growth. It is certainly not the only factor, and I would be really surprised if it is even a major factor contributing to cost growth. It is easy to point at one thing, to come up with a simple solution, when in reality, this is such a complex industry that oversimplification is not going to help us get where we need to go.
All right. Well, Julia, I'd like to get you in here as well. Do you have any thoughts that you want to add to that?
I do. I would actually agree with Becky wholeheartedly. If you looked at the ruling behind the 80th percentile rule, that it only applies to a very small population. And when you look at the entire state of Alaska with 740,000 people, roughly, and 240-ish that actually have what we call real insurance, that this would even fall into this category, it only applies to those that are not self-funded plans. So if you take that 240, you bring that back another 120, and there's about 100,000 people that would even remotely be involved in that, because all the other payers are driven by governmental payers or state payers. So the implications, as Becky is saying, I think it's very small. And you also have to think back, it was just in 2010, we were in a growth phase and trying to improve access in Alaska. So there was a big push to get specialists up here. And this is not an easy to recruit to area. And so I think some of that was also part of the drive to have that access be local and protecting patients from what might be a little bit of a geographical difference in those rates. So without question, we have to look at it, but I don't think it's of huge consequence.
That's interesting to know that it doesn't apply overall. Mm-mm. So it's just a specific group.
Everybody else is fixed. So Medicare, Medicaid, the federal payers, TRICARE, the native system is completely separate. So it is actually very small.
And it does not apply to large self-funded plans. It only applies to fully insured plans. So if you look at large employers, usually they're funding their own insurance pool. They're self-funded. So it does not apply to those plans. So as Julie said, when you really get down to how many people are actually covered, it's not that many. So it's hard to attribute the growth mm-hmm. in costs to that particular thing. And I think not just on the 80th percentile, but on a host of other issues, if we decide that one thing is going to fix healthcare, we have missed the mark because we have not understood the complexity and that we have to take a systems approach to looking at this issue.
Well, Julie, getting back to you, what else from your perspective as the CEO of Alaska Regional, do you think is contributing to the higher costs here in Alaska that are, according to the report that Primera put out, are above what we see in other places?
Well, first, the report that Premier put out, to me, is old news. That was 2014 and prior. And I think the market has changed dramatically in the last 18 to 24 months, and that you see more more providers, more facilities going in network and actually working to reduce the rates so that they can be more competitive. So that landscape has changed. But I will tell you, I spent my entire career in the lower 48 until 4 years ago, and it is a higher cost to provide care up here. There's a premium on specialist care as far as within the hospital, if I've got different specialty providers at the bedside that are harder to recruit, we do pay more for that. And then also to recruit people from the lower 48, it's a $20,000 relocation bill. So those are the kind of things that play into that infrastructure. The other part to keep in mind is that we are 24/7 operations there to save lives. And it might bother you that the cost is a little bit higher until you're coming in with chest pain. And you need to have all the infrastructure there and available to save lives. And one of the things that I've seen that's really happening as we have these other communities growing, they want those services in their communities as well. So now, as an example, with cardiology, you know, that is a group that's covering a very big geographical area with life and death care. So, and it's not an easy to recruit specialty either. So it really does leave you at a disadvantage when you're wanting to provide those life-saving services close to home in legitimate areas, while balancing that against the cost of being able to recruit to those areas.
Did you want to add something?
I don't know if we have great data, really, and I think these conversations should be informed by data about what the difference is. We know that organizations like Premier have done studies, and as Julie said, 2014 was a long time ago in the healthcare universe. Healthcare has changed in the state significantly since then. So we don't have good up-to-date information on price. We don't really have good comparative data on utilization. Price, or the price of something is, or the cost of something is the price times the utilization. How much do you use the service? I just saw a study the other day that looked at five different states and the cost of healthcare in those states, and their conclusion was no state is the same. And because no state is the same, no solution's gonna be the same. And so as we move forward, one of the things we need to understand is, rather than speculating about the cost drivers, what can we do to put some data behind it to understand what our cost drivers really are? And then we can tailor a solution that fits our state rather than just, again, kind of speculating about what that might be.
I could add one more thought to that.
Absolutely.
Because I do believe that we get mixed up on what is the cost of what and what the irritant is. First of all, with that small managed care pool, as I was describing, in most states, that's a risk puddle. And you have to be able to spread costs across a large body of people to be able to get the rate improvements that you would have on your health insurance. So health insurance is going to be higher when you have smaller pools. And we don't mix pools across to other markets up in Alaska. So that's a real big differentiator. And then if you're looking at out-of-pocket expense, you know, versus the amount that is actually charged, those are other numbers that are not real, because there's the reimbursed amount and then there's charges that confuse people, and those charges are generally written off.
Are either of you undertaking some of those studies now to get updated information? Is the Hospital and Nursing Home Association engaged in anything like that, that's looking at current costs, especially in light of the changes that we've seen under the Affordable Care Act, and then now the mandate's been rolled back? Are there current studies taking place?
There's nothing that I'm aware of right now. I think if we were to look at any kind of an analysis, it would have to be something at a state level, or that would involve multiple different organizations. So I think there's a group that's working on a project that could potentially lead to that. But at this point in time, we don't really have any information beyond the things we've talked about, the information we've talked about, which is dated and not complete.
So there's certainly a lot of smart people thinking about this, yourselves included, across the state. What are some of the promising things that you're seeing that might be percolating up that could help in this regard as far as expense?
Well, I think a couple of things, and Julie can probably elaborate on some of these more, but you know, there are small pockets of innovation happening across the state. I think one project we've been engaged in from the hospital standpoint is an ER project to really provide better information to our ER clinicians as they're seeing patients, And so we can reduce ER visits. There are some physician groups that are doing some innovative things around care management. So I think there are some pockets of innovation that are promising. There are also people having conversations about healthcare that would not have happened 5 years ago. When we have money, it's easy just to continue to pay bills. When our state has less money, we're much more conscious of those costs. And so I think there are higher level and maybe more strategic conversations happening about healthcare. And I think there are community level conversations happening as well. And those are very important as we move forward. At some point, we really, as a state, are going to have to decide what do we want our healthcare system to look like. Mm-hmm. And then how are we going to pay for it? And those are really important conversations that affect all of us.
Julie, I am glad to kind of lead into the emergency room expense issue. Alaska Regional opened a clinic in Mountain View in 2016, a neighborhood here in Anchorage, in part to help reduce emergency room use and control costs, but it was closed in about 6 months. Mm-hmm. What happened?
It actually was far more complex than we were prepared for. Mm. We had set it up basically as a walk-in clinic that's able to take care of the lower acuity type issues that we figured we could keep out of the emergency room, and what came in the door was far more complex than we were prepared to handle. And you really need to be able to get 15, 20 patients through a day with a small staff to have it even be remotely close to breaking even, and we could barely get 7. These were patients that needed far more than we were ready to support. And so we closed it and figured we better try again and take a different approach. So we're still looking at a way to serve that community. But an example of a collaborative that makes more sense is work that's been done over at the Brother Francis Shelter. And that is work that it's been a collaboration between Providence, Alaska Native, and Alaska Regional, and then South Central Foundation in being able to support care right in that location. And we have medical respite beds that take patients out of the hospital that are homeless and give them time to heal, as opposed to leaving them in the hospital for weeks on end. And also a clinic that's right down in that location that's more comprehensive in nature, and that is actually saved a ton of emergency room visits. So it really is a much better model than what we tried to put together in Mountain View.
So let's talk a little more about that. I heard a story recently on NPR about telemedicine, how it was this shiny new concept on the East Coast, and I thought, well, Alaska's been doing that for a long time. But the way that they were using it was to reduce emergency room visits by having people who had, you know, less urgent need actually using telemedicine to talk with a doctor, talk with a nurse, and get some preliminary sort of diagnosis or discussion about it. What happened with the experiment in Mountain View that do you think could have changed if it would have been set up differently? What went wrong in that effort?
Well, first of all, I think having a seasoned provider that was able to risk stratify the type of cases that were coming in the door would have been, the provider we had was wonderful, and it was still really hard as a newer practitioner to be able to decide what things I can fix at this point in time. And when you look at something that is essentially a train wreck that needs all these things, it's really hard to prioritize that. That would have helped. Also being able to have social work available to help balance some of those issues, and also behavioral health. And it takes a lot of coordination. And the other thing that really added to it is that you're in a neighborhood where you want to have security. And at the end of the day, I had six people taking care of 7 patients a day. The math doesn't work between the front desk and having security and a lab and the providers and such. So it really wasn't, it didn't end up serving who I thought we'd serve. I thought we would get the, like I said, the lower acuity, sore throats, things that don't mm-hmm. need to be in the ER. But we have got such pent-up demand for people with very, very complex issues in our entire community that I should have thought that forward better than I did.
Do you think there's room to sort of revisit a more robust yep. effort?
There is. I've
actually
got a
meeting
tomorrow. Instead
of an emergency room, maybe more of a type of a clinic setting?
There is, yes. And actually the Rasmussen Foundation has been involved as well. And we are working on a possible alternative of how we can serve that community in the weeks to come. So we have not given up on that location.
So other ways to reduce emergency room costs. I'm sure that you've got ideas along those lines. And Becky, I also wanted to ask, Is telemedicine another way that could be used across the state to do just that, to have people check in with a doctor or a nurse? I know that some hospitals have a nurse on call that you can consult with before driving to the hospital in the middle of the night. Is telemedicine something that could be used in that respect?
Telemedicine certainly has a lot of promise, and it is actually widely adopted, especially in the tribal health system, to, you know, with great results. So I think it's definitely something that we need to continue to look at. But one of the challenges with telemedicine, I think, or the challenges in the system that telemedicine may not be the best thing to address, is these really, really complex patients like Julie was talking about. You really need that. It may be a component of addressing their needs, but again, when you have a patient with multiple chronic conditions who really needs a social worker to help them navigate and who might have a behavioral health condition, you're really talking about needing comprehensive services to help surround that person. And if you look at the number of people, at where we spend our healthcare dollars, it's those really, really complex patients where we're spending the majority of our healthcare dollars, not necessarily the family with a kid with an ear infection who can avoid the ER visit. So we've got to figure out a better way to help manage those folks who are really, really complex.
Mm-hmm. Julie, are there other things that you're looking at to help reduce emergency room use?
I think being able to support more primary care in the community is a big part of that. And we are adding providers to our senior health clinic in South Anchorage. And also we have the My Health Clinic that's in South Anchorage as well, and trying to add enough providers so we can meet the community need, because that's a big part of it. A lot of these visits that come are people that do not have primary care access. And Medicare in particular is not a favored population to be serving. It does not pay well, but they're the ones that need it the most. So being able to come up with strategies that we can provide more primary care support, I think, would be very important in that.
Julie, I know that Becky, I know that you're part of a group statewide that's working on what's called the Blueprint for Healthcare in Alaska. Tell us about that. What is it?
So its name is kind of evolving as the group has evolved. I think there was a recognition last year during the legislative session that healthcare costs were growing. It was becoming an increasing concern at the state level as the budget deliberations were happening, and that absent looking at the system holistically, solutions were going to be one-offs. They were going to be, let's address this particular small issue or that particular small issue.
Like the 80th percentile.
Which could have unintended consequences if you're not looking at the entire system. So there was a recognition that we needed some kind of effort to look at the broader system as a community, as stakeholders, with providers at the table. Providers have to be part of the solution. And there really was no one coordinating such an effort. So I think the group has been somewhat informal until the last couple months. It's looking for funding. I think that's the next big step, is will the group get funding to actually begin the work? But so far, the state administration's involved. The state House of Representatives has someone on the panel, and the state Senate. And providers and other groups. So it's an attempt to say, let's all get in the same room and talk about this, and do it in a way that makes sense to the entire system so that we're not creating problems.
Well, we only have about a minute and a half left, so what would you both like to see from, you talked a little about the needs for state government to do certain things, but what do you want to see both from state leadership and the federal side to address the continued rise in prices?
That's a really complicated question. I'm going to give a really quick answer. I think we've got to get at the same, we all have to get at the same table, party affiliations aside, and work on what we want our system to be in 5 years and in 10 years. But we have to get beyond some of the types of conversations we're having now, even among the provider community, where we're pointing fingers at each other to say, this is our community problem, we are the ones who have to solve it, but we can't do that in isolation.
Julie, final thoughts?
I would actually like to see consumers be more aware and take more ownership in their health and wellness dashboard and really taking care of themselves and being proactive. Some of the most expensive care we provide is end of life, and how many people really have an advance directive and are making those decisions before they need to be made. So I agree that there's a federal piece, but there's a lot of decisions that are made that are emotional. and being able to be on that same page as far as, you know, how you're going to handle those conversations at end of life, I think would also be a value.
Well, thank you so much to both you, Julie Taylor, the CEO of Alaska Regional Hospital in Anchorage, and Becky Hultberg, CEO, President and CEO of the Alaska State Hospital and Nursing Home Association. Sorry, I had to get that mouthful right. Thanks so much for being here tonight.
Thank you.
Alaska has a complicated system of state, federal, tribal, and community-based healthcare programs in a state that is at a great distance from the rest of the country. As you've heard this evening from a physician specialist who benefited from the high rates that can be charged here, and from hospital executives who grapple with working toward good health outcomes, a lot will depend on what state and federal lawmakers do to address healthcare costs, and whether Congress decides to change other elements of the Affordable Care Act or dismantle it altogether. Thanks for watching Alaska Insight. Each week on Alaska Insight, we will continue to go into the community and look beyond the headlines to provide perspective on the issues that have Alaskans talking. You can connect with us and watch Alaska Insight online by going to alaskapublic.org. You can also engage with us on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Thoughtful comments from viewers will help us determine future topics of discussion. We return next week at 7:30 p.m., right after Washington Week. In the meantime, stay informed and connected by listening to Morning Edition, Alaska News Nightly, and Talk of Alaska on your local public radio station. Thanks for joining Alaska Public Media for this edition of Alaska Insight. I'm Lori Townsend. Have a great night.